Can I remind members of the COVID-related measures that are in place and that face covering should be worn when moving around the chamber and across the Holyrood campus? The first item of business is health and social care portfolio questions. And of course, as ever, in order to get in as many people as possible, I would prefer short and succinct questions and answers to match. And also, if a member wishes to request a supplementary question, they should press their request to speak button or indicate so in the chat function by entering the letter R during the relevant question. Question number one, Alexander Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on the number of referrals to child and adolescent mental health services that are declined.
Minister Kevin Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Referrals not accepted for treatment are described as rejected or not accepted, not as declined, as in many cases this involves signposting or redirecting to a more appropriate service. The last available published statistics covering quarter ending 30th of June show that 2,263, that's 22.2% of referrals to CAMHS, were not accepted. The next published statistics will be available on the 7th of December.
Alexander Stewart.
I thank the Minister for that response. In 2018, Audit Scotland, through the report on children and young people's mental health, warned that the scrutiny of CAMHS focused on inputs and outputs rather than outcomes. Since then, what action has the Scottish Government taken to shift the focus of outcomes, and how will it measure service quality to seek to increase pathways for the mental health of our children?
Minister.
Presiding Officer, there has been significant progress made to improve CAMHS services and implement the recommendations of the Children and Young People's Mental Health and Wellbeing Task Force. Most notably, in February of 2020, the Scottish Government published a national CAMHS service specification which includes nationally agreed referral criteria, a first engagement appointment for all those that meet the criteria, and personalised and meaningful signposting for all those that do not require treatment in CAMHS. There's also a duty for all CAMHS teams to provide a contact for referrers to discuss referrals with them. And we are continuing to work on data in all of this. We have in place the CAMHS and Psychological Therapies National Dataset, which was commissioned to collect data around about why people are not accepted. CAPTND was first published as an appendix in June 2021 publications. And we'll continue to work on that and improve as we move forward.
And supplementary, Carol Mochan.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. It was reported by Public Health Scotland that at the end of June 2021, the number of children and young people who had been waiting over a year for mental health services had doubled from the end of June 2020. Can the Minister actually advise Parliament what examples of alternative support the government has in place for those children on very long waiting lists, or indeed who may have been rejected by the service?
Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. As Ms Mochan knows, we have invested quite heavily from our Recovery and Renewal Fund into CAMHS to bring waiting times down. It is essential that we do so. We also need to invest in other services, particularly community-based services, so that folks don't have to be referred to acute services in the first place. That is absolutely essential, an absolutely essential move in moving away from acute to prevention. And I'm sure that that's something Ms Mochan will welcome, along with everyone else in the Chamber. But we are working hard, along with health boards, to get those waiting lists and waiting times down.
Question number two, Martin Whitfield.
I'm very grateful, Deputy Presiding Officer, to ask the Scottish Government what assessment it has made on the impact of the closure of Eddington Cottage Hospital.
Minister Kevin Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. East Lothian Health and Social Care Partnership has taken the difficult decision to temporarily relocate the bed capacity, that's 6 beds, and staff from Eddington Hospital to East Lothian Community Hospital to maintain safe staffing levels and provide safe and functional care for patients. The Health and Social Care Partnership will review this decision on the 10th of December as part of an agreed quarterly review of the situation.
Martin Whitfield.
I'm very grateful for that answer. Could I ask, as he's in his place, the Cabinet Secretary, whether he would meet with the steering group ahead of the discussions that will lead to the decision on the 10th of December to help support NHS Lothian in reopening this cottage hospital?
I believe Minister Kevin Stewart has got a reply.
I know for a fact that the Cabinet Secretary has already met with the local constituency member, Paul McLennan, on this issue. And as always, the Government will continue to speak to those that are in the know, including local members, on these matters.
And supplementaries from Craig Coy.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Eddington Hospital was closed with no community consultation whatsoever. Minister, even in a pandemic, is this an acceptable way for the NHS to operate?
Minister.
What I would say to Mr Hoy is that we are in a pandemic. There are staff shortages, and the reason why East Lothian Health and Social Care Partnership took the decision that they did was to ensure that there were safe levels of staffing for patients. Safety should always come first, Presiding Officer, and that is what East Lothian Health and Social Care Partnership have done in this case.
And supplementary from Paul McLennan.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what measures NHS Lothian and East Lothian Health and Social Care Partnership are undertaking in regard to recruiting additional staff in East Lothian.
Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Decisions on local staffing requirements and recruitment are the responsibility of individual NHS boards. However, Scottish Government officials are continually engaging with boards to identify particular areas of concern. As well as officials, the Cabinet Secretary and I have been talking to health boards, to health and social care partnerships and local authorities, on a regular basis around about these issues. NHS Lothian advised through ongoing capacity reporting to the Scottish Government that measures to deploy staff flexibly and recruit additional staff are currently in progress. And the member can be assured that we'll continue to monitor that progress.
Question number three, Bill Kidd.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government how its winter care plan will ensure that adults in care homes will have continued and frequent access indoors to family and friends.
Minister Kevin Stewart.
Presiding Officer, the Adult Social Care Winter Preparedness Plan 2021-22 sets out the measures to protect the sector ahead of winter and outlines how we will support those who use services, the workforce and unpaid carers. The plan recognises the considerable progress that has been made by care homes in supporting people to see their family and friends through the implementation of the Scottish Government's Open with Care visiting guidance. It outlines our commitment to build on this progress, working with partners, including the Care Inspectorate and local oversight teams, to ensure that care homes continue to be supported to normalise visiting opportunities. I remain committed to developing legislation in support of Anne's Law so that those who live in adult homes have rights to see and spend time with the people that are important to them. We have sought views through a public consultation following the commitment made in our programme for government to deliver Anne's Law, and we will consider these views carefully and publish the responses as soon as possible. Presiding Officer, Anne's Law is named after Anne Duke, who sadly died last week. My thoughts and condolences are with Anne's husband and family, and we will be doing everything possible to honour Anne's legacy by getting Anne's Law right.
Bill Kidd.
Thank the Minister for that response very much. During the pandemic, there has been a high turnaround of care home staff, and the importance of caring roles has been reinforced by the difficulties of the past year. Can the Minister advise to what extent Brexit has had an impact on staff vacancies in care, and can the Scottish Government forecast that care homes will have enough staff to meet caring needs over the winter period?
Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Brexit has had a major impact on staffing in the social care and other sectors. And one organisation that I spoke to a few weeks back had lost 40%, 40% of their staff in one service because folks had returned to their home countries because they did not feel as welcome as they should be here because of the hostile environment policies. I hear the Conservative
Excuse me, Minister, could we have less, less commentary from sedentary positions, please? Minister, please resume.
From a sedentary position, folks are murmuring, Presiding Officer, but these are the realities. 40% of staff in one service gone. That obviously has a profound impact in the delivery of services in many parts of our country. The government, the Scottish Government, has continued to speak to the UK Government on this issue. Colleagues and I spoke with UK ministers just the other week on the difficulties that Brexit is causing in terms of our social care services. I have to say we were not really listened to. That does not mean to say that we will not continue to pursue the UK Government on these issues. And beyond that, we have recently written to the Migration Advisory Committee outlining the difficulties that we face, difficulties that have been also highlighted by Scottish Care and Dr. Donald McCaskill. We will do everything possible to aid recruitment and retention within social care over the course of this winter. I would urge all members who may have constituents who are seeking careers in social care to advise them to look at myjobscotland.com to see the range of posts that are currently available.
Supplementary Willie Rennie.
Yeah, thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I support Angelo, but I am concerned that we wait for that legislation before the rights of families and friends is secured. And I'm sure the Minister will agree with me that quality of life is incredibly important. So what can the Minister say to me to reassure families that we won't end up with a repeat of what we had during the pandemic, or where months on end that families were excluded from seeing their loved ones?
Minister.
Presiding Officer, I agree with Willie Rennie that folk are deserving of quality visits with family and friends. That is extremely important. And that's why we have put in place the Open with Care policy. It is one that I take a careful view on and we monitor very, very carefully indeed. I also monitor all of the correspondence that comes into government where families are having difficulty in accessing care homes. I have to say that there has been no correspondence in the past 2 weeks around about that. I also have regular discussions with the Care Inspectorate, who are also monitoring this. I'm due to meet with them again this afternoon. It is vital that care homes follow the Open with Care policy. And if any member finds that that's not the case in their constituency or region, I'd be happy to hear from them and deal with that accordingly.
Thank you. And before calling the next questioner, can I just make a plea again for succinct questions and succinct answers? Otherwise, not all members will have the opportunity to pose the question that they have been preparing to pose. Question number four, Liam Kerr.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what plans it has to tackle the reported backlog of colorectal cancer screening.
Minister Marie Todd.
Since the BAL screening programme resumed in October 2020, invitations to participate in screening have been issuing at the same rate as they were before the pandemic. However, invitations to existing participants are issuing 7 months later than they would have without the pause in March 2020. Anyone who turned 50 after the programme resumed will receive a kit shortly after their birthday as normal. Any patient referred with an urgent suspicion of cancer after screening, including those from the BAL screening programme, have and will remain a priority in accessing diagnostic tests, hopefully rule cancer out. To ensure that in this, we've invested in 4 additional mobile units to support scope-based diagnostics, one of which is stationed at our National Hospital at the Golden Jubilee. We'll also shortly publish the Endoscopy and Urology Recovery and Renewal Plan, which will embed further improvements and ultimately work towards reducing waiting times and provide equitable access.
Liam Kerr.
I thank the Minister for that answer, but constituents have reported to me that Angus residents as far north as Edsall must travel to Dundee and Perth to receive endoscopy and colonoscopy services. Now, after mental health and stroke care was centralised away from Stacathro, the suggestion is that cancer screening and detection has gone the same way. So does the Minister accept that it is long past time for the NHS winter plan and beyond to recognise that the withdrawal of local health care, such as in Angus, is storing up bigger problems in things like screening for the future?
Minister.
So in response to that particular point, I would say that many boards are working really hard to ensure that, to take the pressure off their central units, to ensure that they are using all the facilities right out in the community and working closely with primary care. Boards are working tirelessly to see patients in as timely a way as possible based on their clinical need. There are 2 mobile endoscopy units, one of which operates in NHS Tayside, and a further 2 are to be brought in stream in the next couple of months. And that additional 2 mobile endoscopy units will provide 4 rooms. So by January 22, there will be 6 mobile endoscopy rooms in total across Scotland, which will increase the number of patients who can be seen and in turn reduce waiting times for endoscopy.
Question number 5, Kenneth Gibson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what impact air pollution has on mortality and morbidity.
Minister Marie Todd.
The relationship between air quality and health is extremely complex. It's generally difficult to say with certainty what impact air pollution has on specific individuals. However, we do know that the very young, the elderly and those with pre-existing health conditions are particularly vulnerable to the impacts of poor air quality. The Scottish Government recognises that the air that we breathe is fundamental to our health, and compared to the rest of the UK and other parts of Europe, Scotland enjoys a high level of air quality. And at the time, evidence continues to grow on the impacts of poor air quality, expanding our understanding of how air pollution is harmful to public health and to the environment. In July this year, we published a new air quality strategy to set out the Scottish Government's policy framework for the next 5 years and a series of actions to deliver further air quality improvement.
Kenneth Gibson.
I thank the Minister for that response. Asthma UK and the British Lung Foundation research found that 81% of births in Scotland last year were in local authorities with unsafe levels of air pollution, exceeding World Health Organization guidelines for fine particulate matter. Meanwhile, 6 roads, including the A737, which runs through my own constituency, still exceed the legal limit for nitrogen oxide. Can the Minister advise as to when low emission zones will be extended from the 4 main cities, which will include Edinburgh from next year, to other cities and large towns, and the health benefits that will bring?
Minister.
Beyond the 4 cities of Aberdeen, Dundee, Edinburgh and Glasgow, local authorities with air quality management areas, those are AQMAs, require to undertake a national low emissions framework assessment to determine the suitability of a local emission zone, an LEZ, for the air quality issues that they might be experiencing. And to date, no other Scottish local authorities have determined that an LEZ is appropriate. However, all local authorities with AQMAs must produce an action plan detailing how air quality will be improved.
And supplementary, Brian Whittle.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I think the worst cases of morbidity due to pollution and emissions is within our urban areas. Can I ask what discussions the Minister has had with other portfolios to encourage the use of low-emission vehicles in cities to the health benefit of those who live there?
Minister.
So the member asked an excellent question. Human health improvements are not related solely to direct reductions in air pollution. The policies that can improve air quality can potentially have potentially have multiple co-benefits for population health. They also address inequality and for mitigating and adapting to climate change. And a prime example is the policy to promote active travel, which I know the member is passionate about. Walking, wheeling, cycling can increase physical activity, significantly reduce cardiovascular incidence and mortality, and has been shown to reduce all-cause mortality, even after controlling for other physical activities. So that's a particular priority for the government at the moment, and you can see very clearly how we are working cross-portfolio to deliver on that particular benefit for the citizens of Scotland.
Question number six, Paul Sweeney.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what steps it is taking to address the reported backlog in at-home COVID-19 booster and flu vaccine appointments in the NHS Greater Glasgow and Clyde Health Board area.
Cabinet Secretary Hamza Youssef.
Well, this cohort is appointed locally. We're working closely with all health boards, of course, including NHS Greater Glasgow and Clyde, to ensure people are prioritised according to risk. Following JCVI advice, health boards prioritised administering boosters to highest priority groups. That I make the point that I know has been made by other colleagues and myself previously, that the moment we received that advice, there was already a backlog, which of course Greater Glasgow and Clyde are working through. Greater Glasgow and Clyde, like all health boards, is accelerating its vaccination programme to ensure as many eligible people are protected as possible ahead of the festive season. Figures from the UK dashboard, of course, show that we have administered boosters or third doses to a greater proportion of the population than any other UK nation.
Paul Sweeney.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer, but the reality of this backlog for vulnerable people is quite stark. And one of my constituents' cases, she was 83 years of age and she had to wait over a month for a home vaccine appointment. So when I made representations on our behalf to the Health Board in Glasgow, I was told that the vaccination team was simply too busy to provide her with an appointment date, which left her in a situation where she had to put herself at risk and attend a drop-in clinic to receive her vaccination. So that means that vulnerable people are not well enough, who are not normally well enough to attend these vaccination centres, have been left behind and stuck at home when they're up to Christmas. So can I ask the Cabinet Secretary, what assessment is the government making of the number of people in that situation where they're waiting for at-home appointments and are forced into that position of having to potentially go in person to a facility, putting them at risk? And will the government commit today to ensuring every one of them is vaccinated at home in time for Christmas?
Cabinet Secretary.
I can thank Paul Sweeney for the question. He's right to raise it. That to me is an unacceptably long wait for somebody who is vulnerable. I would make the obvious point. I know Paul Sweeney, of course, is aware of this, that home appointments do take longer. Not only will health boards have to travel to those individuals, there is that 15-minute recovery period thereafter, but nonetheless, of course, those people who are housebound may well have vulnerabilities, often do have vulnerabilities, hence why they cannot travel to a vaccination centre, and my expectation would be that they would be prioritised. I'm happy to give Paul Sweeney a breakdown of the progress that Greater Glasgow and Clyde has made in the vaccination programme. It's good progress, but I have asked Greater Glasgow and Clyde, as well as all health boards right across the country, to give me plans for acceleration in the lead up to the end of the year.
Sandesh Gohani, supplementary.
Thank you. Can the Cabinet Secretary please tell me the date the COVID booster will appear on the Scottish COVID app?
Cabinet Secretary.
We're working with digital colleagues to do that, but we hope to be able to do that early next month.
Supplementary, Paul O'Kane.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. In a previous answer to the First Minister's questions, the First Minister said that elderly constituents having to wait outside of vaccination centres for hours should not happen, and indeed that the Cabinet Secretary was meeting with boards to discuss this. Can you tell me exactly why constituents who are elderly are still having to wait outside in winter weather for their vaccine, and what action has been taken to increase waiting facilities available at vaccination centres?
Cabinet Secretary.
So a couple of points I would make. First and foremost, where people do have to queue up, where they're having to queue up outside, I would expect health boards and local health boards to ensure that they take care of the welfare of those individuals, whether that's by, indeed some, I know health boards have put up marquees, gazebos, they've got heating in place, they've offered water, chairs, etc. So I'd expect the welfare to be taken care of. Of course, my preference would be that there should be no queuing where possible, but we are, of course, accelerating our vaccination programme. 500,000, almost 500,000 flu and booster vaccines administered last week, and that will mean that some people will have to queue. Thankfully, we've made excellent progress through the older age cohorts. We're starting to make progress through those not so older cohorts. But where there are particular concerns of particular health boards and particular vaccination centres where that is still happening, I'm more than happy to hear from members across the chamber, and I'll raise it with the health board in question.
Question number seven, Eleanor Whitman.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on the measures that has been taking part as part of the Women's Health Plan to improve access for women to appropriate support, speedy diagnosis and best treatment for endometriosis.
Minister Marie Todd.
We've developed a national referral pathway that will improve earlier intervention and support within primary care for women with endometriosis, as well as streamlining referrals to secondary and tertiary care for those who need it. To raise awareness of menstrual wellbeing, we're developing new information for NHS Inform, and we funded Endometriosis UK to produce information leaflets that healthcare professionals can signpost to if endometriosis is suspected. This will support women to be better informed and empowered to make choices about their treatment. All of this will launch in spring 2022.
Eleanor Wisdom.
I thank the Minister for this advice. I have recently represented women suffering from endometriosis in my constituency who have had the truly harrowing experiences in relation to the length of time it has taken for them to reach that all-important diagnosis and treatment plan stage. Does the Minister agree with me that any improvements that can be made with reducing waiting times for diagnosing endometriosis and the work based on lived experiences to address inequalities in all aspects of women's health in Scotland are to be welcomed and expedited?
Minister.
Yes, I do agree, and I too have spoken to women with endometriosis and have been moved by the difficulties many of them face in receiving a diagnosis and indeed in being heard. Our Women's Health Plan, published in August, includes a number of actions to improve access to appropriate support, best treatment and speedy diagnosis for endometriosis. Because knowledge is power, the work that we are doing to improve the information on NHS Inform and the patient information leaflet to support the referral pathway are both really important parts of the package, empowering women and helping them to understand what's normal, when to ask for help and what options they have is a really important first step. As I outlined in my previous answer, we're already taking action to reduce the time women with endometriosis have to wait to achieve a diagnosis and access appropriate care. Furthermore, as we implement these actions, we will work with people with lived experience, Endometriosis UK, Public Health Scotland, as well, to identify realistic targets to measure improvement of services and to care for women with endometriosis.
And I will be able to squeeze in question number 8 if I could have brief questions and brief answers. Question number 8, Liam McArthur.
To ask the Scottish Government what discussions it has had with NHS Orkney regarding the COVID-19 booster vaccination programme.
Cabinet Secretary, come to you, sir.
I meet regularly with all health boards, including with NHS Orkney, met with them on Monday, or they were part of a call I was on Monday, where we discussed the autumn-winter vaccination programme.
Liam McArthur.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary. Over recent weeks, Orkney has experienced Scotland's highest rate of COVID cases. At the same time, booster vaccinations have not kept pace with the rollout elsewhere in the country, leading to understandable concern. Thankfully, COVID numbers are declining. The booster vaccination is picking up pace. But what assurances can the Cabinet Secretary provide that all health boards will get the support they need to ensure any future booster programmes are rolled out as quickly as possible?
Cabinet Secretary.
Can I thank Lee McArthur for raising what was an important issue. Of course, the two issues that he raises are interlinked because of the high case rates. It meant there was outbreaks in a number of care homes, and of course then the vaccination teams had to wait before they could go in safely to vaccinate those individuals. To give some assurance, as he asked for, there is now a published timetable published by NHS Orkney in relation to how they intend to get through the priority groups before Christmas. I'm sure he has a copy of that. I hope that gives reassurance to members. But of course, if NHS Orkney require any additional resource whatsoever in relation to the vaccination programme and accelerating it, then I would look upon that extremely sympathetically.
Thank you. And we'll move on to the next portfolio questions, which is social justice, housing and local government. I'll allow a brief pause to allow front benchers to change positions safely. Thank you. Okay, whilst we're just completing that move, could I remind members that if they wish to request a supplementary question, they should press the request to speak button or indicate so in the chat function by entering the letter R during the relevant question. And I call question number one, Beatrice Wishart.
To ask the Scottish Government how its housing strategy supports social landlords to ensure ageing properties meet current energy efficient standards.
Minister Patrick Harvey.
Thank you. The Scottish Government is committed to a just transition to net zero. Our heat and building strategy sets out how we'll accelerate the decarbonisation of heating together with energy efficiency improvements in Scotland's homes. The Scottish Government's Social Housing Net Zero Heat Fund provides financial assistance to social landlords to retrofit their housing stock to meet the energy efficiency standard for social housing, and the fund will make available £200 million over the next 5 years to support social landlords across Scotland installing zero emissions heating systems and energy efficiency measures.
Beatrice Wishart.
Social landlords such as housing associations work hard to provide decent housing, and today's ageing properties require extensive upgrades to meet modern energy efficient standards at great costs. So, given the answer that the Minister has provided, will the Scottish Government ensure that there's enough investment to provide for modernisation and future-proof these upgrades too, as well as ensure that areas with high levels of fuel poverty, such as those in the Highlands and Islands, receive higher levels of resource to address the inequality caused by fuel poverty?
Patrick Harvey.
Thank you. I'm grateful for the level of interest that members from a number of political parties, including Beatrice Wishart, have shown in this issue. The Scottish Government has been clear that while we are committed to investing at least £1.8 billion in this agenda across the built environment more generally, we recognise that much more will be needed, and that's why we're establishing a Green Heat Finance Task Force to look at ways the public sector, the third sector and private sector can invest collectively, both to help landlords, including social landlords and tenants, overcome the investment costs and decarbonise our buildings. And I hope Beatrice Wishart is also aware that the fuel poverty definition now takes account of the additional costs associated with living in remote and rural communities, and we are committed to spending more per head on energy efficiency in remote and rural areas where we know installation and labour costs are higher.
A supplementary, Miles Briggs.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. What response have ministers made to concerns on the installation of unproven heating under the Energy Efficiency Standard for Social Housing, EESSH, resulting in reduced thermal comfort for tenants but at significantly increased costs?
Minister.
Well, we're working actively with the social housing sector on not just the Energy Efficiency Standard for Social Housing, but also on their own work on the ZEST report. We're committed to continuing to work collaboratively with the sector, and we'll listen to any concerns that they have. And if Miles Briggs wants to write to me with any specifics, I'll certainly take that seriously.
And supplementary, Colette Stevenson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I ask the Minister to elaborate on how Scotland's ambitious housing to 2040 vision is strengthened by complementary strategies such as the Heat and Building Strategy and the Draft National Planning Framework 4?
Minister.
Thank you. Colette Stevenson is right. There's a great deal of work happening. I'm really pleased that we have a long-term vision for Scotland's housing landscape to 2040. I think that kind of long-term vision is often requested, not just by social housing providers, but by the private rented sector and by those representing the interests of tenants. We have that long-term vision now. It's associated with the fuel poverty strategy, the heat and building strategy, and as the member mentions, also the Draft National Planning Framework 4, which sets out a vision for how our places will change and brings together a wide range of policies, programmes and action, including transport, energy, environment and housing. The 18 national developments in that framework will support the delivery of a spatial strategy, which has a crucial role to play in supporting our transition to net zero.
Question number two, Sue Webber.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government what it is doing to help tackle the reported affordable housing crisis in Edinburgh.
Cabinet Secretary Shona Robson.
The Government has delivered over 103,000 affordable homes since 2007. We're committed to delivering a further 110,000 affordable homes by 2032, 70% of which will be available for social rent. And during this same period, Edinburgh received £558 million in grant support, which helped contribute to the completion of over 13,000 affordable homes. In this Parliament, Edinburgh will further benefit from the Affordable Housing Supply Programme investment of £233.8 million. Towards the delivery of even more good quality affordable homes, an increase of £32.4 million or 16% on the previous 5 years.
Sue Webber. I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that response. As you stated, the Scottish Government is now allocating resource planning assumptions to all local authorities' areas for the years 2021 to 2022 to support the delivery of more social and affordable homes. Each month, there are over 4,400 households living in temporary accommodation in our capital. And given that Edinburgh is home to about 9.7% of the population of Scotland, but Edinburgh is only being allocated 7.3% of that total budget that you stated, does the Cabinet Secretary agree that Edinburgh is not getting its fair share, considering the number of people in temporary accommodation and the scale of our homelessness crisis?
Cabinet Secretary.
No, I don't agree with that, although I do fully understand the challenges in Edinburgh, and I've had discussions with Councillor Kate Campbell, the convener for housing, for that reason, and we continue to discuss with Edinburgh how we can help them to overcome some of the issues, some of which Sue Webber referred to. The issue of temporary accommodation has obviously been exacerbated by COVID, and we need to support councils to work through that. In terms of the investment this year, the £52.4 million will mean an estimated 865 affordable homes will start on site, and a further 828 homes are expected to be completed, the majority of which will be for social rent. We are looking at options to accelerate affordable housing expenditure in Edinburgh this year, in conjunction with officials at the Council who have so far confirmed the capacity for a further £1 million of support. So we'll continue to support Edinburgh to make sure that they can deliver on their affordable housing programme.
Supplementary, Sarah Boyack.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I refer members to my register of interest? Minister, the Citizens' Assembly asked for a right of affordable housing for young people. Will the Scottish Government agree to this ask, as in Edinburgh, for example, in the past decade, private rents have rocketed with a 40% increase for one-bedroom properties, meaning young people just can't afford to live on their own or even share a flat, given that four-bed flats in the private sector are now around £1,900 a month. So could the Minister talk about the affordable housing access issue, but also give us a timescale on Scottish Government action on private rents? Thank you.
Cabinet Secretary.
So, obviously, we are well aware that many private rented tenants have been struggling, and that some people, particularly young people, as Sarah Boyack pointed out, struggle with the rent levels. Of course, for those who are struggling in tenancies at the moment, we have provided £39 million to support them at this time. And we're also committed to tackling high rents by implementing an effective national system of rent controls by the end of 2025, which, of course, my colleague Patrick Harvey will be taking forward. We'll be publishing a draft rented sector strategy for consultation in the next few weeks, and that will seek views on changes to tenancy arrangements, as well as taking forward a consensus on improving information about rent levels, leading to option for rent controls and better regulation. And I would encourage Sarah Boyack to contribute to that consultation.
A supplementary, David Torrance.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Would the Cabinet Secretary agree with me that Edinburgh Council's consultation on short-term let control areas, which closed earlier this month and is currently being reviewed in the City Chambers, is proof that local authorities being empowered under the Scottish Government to find tailored solutions to their own housing challenges?
Cabinet Secretary.
I do agree with David Torrance. We know that in certain areas, particularly tourist hotspots such as Edinburgh, that there are high numbers of short-term lets. that can cause problems for neighbours and make it harder for people to find homes to live in. So the powers that have been given to local authorities to designate control areas, combined with those in the licensing scheme, I think are sufficient to manage high concentrations of short-term lets where this is an issue. The regulation of short-term lets is really vital to balance the needs and concerns that communities have raised with, of course, the wider economic and tourism interests. So I do look forward to hearing about Edinburgh Council's plans following consideration of the outcome of their recent consultation by their planning committee.
Question number three, Jenny Minto.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on the impact of the Open Market Shared Equity Scheme in Argyll and Bute.
Cabinet Secretary.
Over the last 5 years, 11 properties have been purchased in Argyll and Bute with support from the Open Market Shared Equity Scheme. In addition, 80 properties were purchased with support from the First Home Fund last financial year. The Scottish Government currently offers a range of schemes to assist first-time buyers and priority groups to access affordable home ownership. The first-time buyer relief for land and buildings transaction tax means that an estimated 8 out of 10 first-time buyers continue to pay no tax at all.
Jenny Minto.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. Due to the COVID pandemic, it appears the pressure on housing stock in many rural and island areas like Argyll and Bute is increasing property prices. Last week on Mull, I met with Mull and Iona Community Trust to express concern about the lack of support available for local people who wish to use this scheme. Would the Cabinet Secretary provide an update on whether the thresholds in this scheme will be reviewed to take account of inflated property prices in communities like Mull?
Cabinet Secretary.
So the short answer is yes, the annual review of the Open Market Shared Equity Scheme threshold prices is currently underway, and we expect to publish new threshold prices by the end of the year. These will be reflective of the latest house price data available to the Scottish Government. Early indications are that a high number of threshold prices will see an increase. And while we're keen to see more people access support, the Open Market Shared Equity Scheme is an affordable housing scheme, and the threshold prices reflect that. And that's why we ask applicants who are offered a passport letter to be as flexible as possible about the areas and properties that they'll consider purchasing.
Question number four, Audrey Nicol.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government how many people have received the low income pandemic payment.
Minister Ben McPherson.
By the end of October 2021, around 500,000 households had received our £130 low income pandemic payment. And these are households who received council tax reduction or households not liable for council tax, for example, those in homeless accommodation. This investment of up to £65 million was part of a range of actions we took to support low-income households during the pandemic and provide direct financial support during that difficult time. Local authorities have worked hard to deliver this vital payment for us and will provide full details of the final number of payments shortly.
Audrey Nicol.
I thank the Minister for that answer, and I warmly welcome the low-income pandemic payment. We know that many people are struggling as a result of the pandemic and the increase in living costs, so this will have a huge difference. What more is the Scottish Government doing with those powers it has to support low-income families over the winter period, and what more could the Scottish Government do if it had full powers?
Minister.
In addition we are putting over £130 million in the pockets of families this year through our Scottish Child Payment and bridging payments. We also continue to provide support through our Scottish Welfare Fund and discretionary housing payments, together worth over £100 million this year. And we have recently announced a £41 million winter support fund to support people struggling financially this winter. Of course, with full powers, we could do more. For example, we could support families by delivering a social security system that provides better support across all benefit areas. And if we had powers over employment law, we could ensure fair, flexible work and mandatory payment of the real living wage.
Question number five, Michael Mara.
To ask the Scottish Government how it ensures local authorities are compliant with best practice in building standards.
Minister Patrick Harvey.
Thank you. The Scottish Government monitors the performance of all building standards services within local authorities through quarterly performance returns. They adhere to a performance framework that sets out the importance of sharing best practice. Officials also offer, where it's needed, tailored support to local authorities and facilitate sharing best practice through a national engagement programme. Since 2017, overall performance levels for local authority building standard services have improved across Scotland, and I expect this to continue.
Michael Mara.
I thank the Minister for that answer. He may be aware that the SNP administration in Dundee have been forced to spend over £4 million to replace roof tiles due to the original installations, also under the same administration, not meeting safety regulations. This, of course, diverts resources from other services in an already crippling financial environment. Does the Minister agree that the savage cuts made to local government over the lifetime of this government has made such unexpected spending much harder for councils to absorb?
Minister.
Well, I am aware that this is a situation that a number of members for Dundee and the wider region of many different political parties have expressed serious concern about. It arises, as Michael Mara will know, not from building standards, but from a change to the British safety standard, a different regulatory regime and a failure on the part of the local authority to pick up a change to that British safety standard, for which the local authority has apologised, and on a cross-party basis, agreement has been reached to hold an independent inquiry into that. I think we should all have confidence in the ability of the local authority to conduct that inquiry and hopefully to take its recommendations extremely seriously, as indeed we would expect all local authorities to do.
Supplementary, Alexander Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. On safety concerns, over 4 years have passed since the Grenfell tragedy in 2017, yet the government have only just confirmed consultation on whether it will ban combustible materials at high-rise buildings. Can I therefore ask the Minister when we will see action taken on this issue, and can the Minister confirm that any future ban on combustible materials will be truly comprehensive?
Minister.
Well, we do have an active review of building standards, consultation of building standards. I would encourage the member to contribute to that consultation if he wishes. And if he wishes to write to us on the specific issues relating to the Grenfell inquiry, colleagues will reply to that letter.
And supplementary, Joe Fitzpatrick.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I understand that a significant number of my constituents are affected by the serious issue raised by Mr Mara, and they will be understandably concerned. They will be hugely disappointed by the politicisation of this issue by Mr Mara, and will welcome, I think, the commitment by Dundee City Council for a full independent external review. But can I ask the Minister if he will use his position to seek assurances from the Council that they will rectify these issues as quickly as possible and with as little disruption to those affected?
Minister.
Well, I would certainly support that call. And I hope that everybody, regardless of party politics, supports that kind of quick resolution with as little disruption as possible that Joe Fitzpatrick is calling for. I welcome the fact, once again, that Dundee City Council have apologised for the quality of the work and for not picking up on the change to the British safety standard, and have approved the review that will take place. And I would appeal to all members across the political spectrum to support any local authority which picks up on an issue like this to resolve it, to get a solution for the people affected, rather than turning it into a political football.
Question number six, Dean Lockhart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government how its housing strategy will support the retrofitting of homes to improve energy efficiency and to tackle fuel poverty.
Minister Patrick Harvey.
Thank you. Housing to 2040, as well as the fuel poverty strategy and the heat and building strategy, together set out our approach to decarbonising heat and eradicating fuel poverty. We've run a number of advice and funding schemes. We've increased investment to £268 million in this year, and we've committed to invest at least £1.8 billion during this Parliament to kickstart market growth and to support those least able to pay. And as I mentioned earlier in relation to Beatrice Wishart's question, we're establishing a Green Heat Finance Task Force to recommend ways that the public sector, communities and private investors can collaborate to scale up investment and help households overcome the upfront investment costs.
Dean Lockhart.
I thank the Minister for his response. He mentioned the heat in building strategy, which estimates it will cost £33 billion to retrofit Scotland's housing stock. Can the Minister clarify how this funding will be divided between public sector funding and private sector funding, And there's also a lot of confusion over how much funding will be available for individual households to help them replace existing fossil fuel boilers. Can the Minister undertake to clarify what financial assistance will be available to individual households to replace their boilers?
Minister.
Well, on the latter point, I can certainly say that the level of support to individual households in Scotland is higher than that provided by the UK scheme. The UK government's boiler upgrade scheme, for example, looks set to offer grants of £5,000 to £6,000 for renewable heat systems. But the Home Energy Scotland scheme that the Scottish Government funds, it gives interest-free loans for homeowners with cashback grants of up to £7,500 for zero-emission heating, plus up to £6,000 for energy efficiency measures. I hope that the Government has the support of members across the Chamber in providing that support to householders. But on the first point that Dean Lockhart raises, I'm sure he understands that the answer is no. I cannot pin down right now, and no government would be able to pin down right now exactly what the share of costs will be right through to 2045. That's why we're looking to create a Green Heat Finance Task Force to cast the net wide for a very wide range of measures to ensure that the investment necessary is available. The only alternative would be for Mr Lockhart to come forward with a £33 billion tax rise to suggest to us if he wants the public sector to pay for the lot.
Question number 7, Siobhan Brown.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'd like to declare an interest if I'm still sitting.
I'm not sure if the microphone is on, Ms Brown. Maybe try to reinsert the card, or? I think I heard.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'd like to declare an interest as I'm still a sitting councillor at South Ayrshire Council. Can I ask the Scottish Government what action is it taking to ensure that construction firms adhere to the highest building standards?
Minister Patrick Harvey.
Thank the member for the question. The Scottish Government established a ministerial working group which considered building standards compliance and enforcement immediately after the tragic events at Grenfell Tower in 2017. The recommendations have been taken forward under the Building Standards Futures Board. The compliance plan, which the Futures Board is leading, seeks to improve levels of compliance through greater checking and evidence gathering, as well as creating a new compliance plan manager for high-risk buildings. A consultation is currently underway on the compliance plan manager role and strengthening enforcement.
Siobhan Brown.
Thank you. I thank the Minister for that answer. I have a constituent who's been in touch who bought a new build flat several years ago where the habitation certificate had been granted. It later transpired that the flats had very little sound or fireproofing, and after a multitude of surveys at the cost to the residents, it's been deemed that the health and safety standards of the building are inadequate. The builder went into liquidation shortly after the sale of the flats. I ask the Scottish Government what procedures are in place to protect people who buy properties in good faith and then builders go into liquidation and are not accountable for their development.
Minister.
Thank you. Well, I suspect everybody across the chamber again will want to say, along with Siobhan Brown and myself, that this kind of situation is not acceptable. People have a right to security in their home. That's part of the Scottish Government's approach to a fundamental understanding of adequate housing as a human right. I think we would all have a great deal of concern about people who've been placed in this kind of situation. In relation to the expected levels of quality of a new built house, we want to see the system strengthened so that buyers can purchase a new build home with confidence and have access to efficient and effective remediation if things do go wrong. And we have a number of measures that we're currently consulting on to do so. The UK government introduced the Building Safety Bill this year, and that includes provision for a new homes ombudsman scheme and a requirement that developers of new build housing belong to that scheme. We're working with the UK government as the bill moves through the UK Parliament to try and achieve a UK-wide scheme that works for Scotland while still respecting the devolution settlement. In the meantime, a homeowner should contact the home warranty provider to establish the extent of the warranty, and they should also consider taking independent legal advice from a solicitor or advice agency to establish if they have options available to them to pursue.
Thank you. And I can squeeze in question 8. If I could please have succinct questions and answers. Question 8, Neil Gray.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government if it will provide an update on the rollout of the new Scottish Child Disability Payment.
Minister Ben McPherson.
I'm delighted and very proud to say that on Monday we successfully launched Child Disability Payment nationally. This is a significant milestone in the development and delivery of Social Security in Scotland, and I want to take this opportunity to record my thanks to all the civil servants involved and others in this achievement. Following our successful pilot, families of children and young people with a disability who are not already in receipt of DLA Child can now apply for this benefit. For the 52,000 people already getting DLA Child, we have successfully started the safe and secure transfer of cases from the DWP, and this will complete by spring 2023. It's gone successfully well. There's a lot more I could say if I had more time, Presiding Officer, but I'll conclude there.
Thank you. Neil Gray.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I thank the Minister for that answer and also welcome this new payment. Can I ask the Minister to expand on how he will make sure that people are aware of the changes and also how they can apply?
Minister.
Well, Social Security Scotland has a multi-channel approach to raising awareness in place, including targeted social media advertising, press releases and a radio campaign. In advance of introduction, officials engaged with over 2,000 stakeholders via virtual roadshows and provided resources to help them promote the new payment and case transfer process. In addition, the Chief Executive of Social Security Scotland and I have written to all MSPs, MPs and local authority leaders seeking their support and raising awareness. And we have also ensured that everyone can apply by whatever channel suits them best, whether that's by paper, by phone, online, or face-to-face. And can I just say, Presiding Officer, that just a number of weeks ago we debated the issue of promoting benefits here in Scotland in this chamber, and I was also asked about it in committee. And I was therefore disappointed and somewhat dispirited that I did not see more uptake from colleagues, particularly on the opposition benches, promoting the launch of CDP on Monday. And I asked them, in the interests of their constituents, to please be part of that shared responsibility and endeavour to raise awareness that child disability payment is now available to families across Scotland.
Thank you. And that concludes portfolio questions. Sorry, is that a point of order, Ms Webber? Yeah. Point of order, Sue Webber.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. In part of my question too, in the social justice and housing, I should have declared an interest as an assisting councillor in Edinburgh.
Thank you. That's now in the record. That concludes portfolio questions, and there will be a very short pause before we move on to the next item of business. Thank you.